in this KBA of whatever we speak about today. So now I'll go into the main topic. First, I will just discuss some basic design changes, and then I will deep dive into COPA. So what you see here is the picture of accounting in the classical ERP. You have the general ledger in the middle and different applications posed to their own tables, different currencies used by different applications. And due to this, reconciliation between components can be tricky since data is typically at different levels of granularity. Okay, so now this is the picture of the brand new world where all applications post to the Universal Journal. Universal Journal is where all journal entries from all accounting applications are stored. And this is the table, ACDOCA. ACDOCA basically stands for, AC stands for accounting, DOC stands for document, and A for actuals. So it's accounting, document, actuals, ACDOCA. So the Universal Journal is the one table that stores all transactional data from the former general ledger, management accounting, asset accounting, and material ledger. From management accounting point of view, this means that there are two types of journal entry in the Universal Journal. The first type covers payroll costs, material expenses, revenue postings, and so on, where the CO account assignment is an extension of the journal entry. Here the posting is to a GL account whose master data has been extended to include the settings for a primary cost element. So these are like direct postings, VF01, FB01, MB01, like that. The second type of posting covers allocation, settlements and all, so where the CO object represents the senders and receivers of an allocation or settlement. This is similar to the old idea of real-time integration in the new GL. But the posting is done using the secondary cost element. So the Universal Journal has a very wide view. There are no walls anymore between management accounting and financial accounting. This is possible due to the HANA database, as we could break the traditional barriers on table sizes. Also due to the speed of the HANA database, we no longer need the concept of total tables. So this enables the all-in-one view. Reconciliation efforts are no longer required. Many of you who have worked in classical ERP and also probably continue to do so know how much efforts are required for reconciliation. Again, this is a picture of how it is in classical ERP, where you have your GL accounts are separate and the cost elements are two separate entities. And for the P&L accounts, you can specify as the primary cost element if you want the data to flow to CO, and the secondary cost elements are always independent in CO. Now, in S4, basically, we have only one maintenance for the GL accounts and the cost elements. They are basically merged. So we have balance sheet accounts, and then we have three types of P&L accounts that you can see here: non-operating expense, revenues, primary cost elements, and the secondary cost elements. So the first two are not relevant for controlling. Okay, they will not be created as cost elements. The last two will be created as cost elements. So the completely new approach here is that we have P&L accounts for the secondary cost elements as well. All these are cost elements that are used to during the settlement and allocation, right? So during the migration to Simple Finance, we have to merge all the cost elements in the accounts. So new accounts are created for the secondary cost elements. So since we do not have the separate cost element master data anymore, the default account assignment maintained in the cost element master data is migrated to OKD9. So this is a question we keep getting, that, you know, before migration we had only 50 entries in OKD9. After migrating we have like 150 entries. How did this happen? So this can happen if the cost element master data is different from what is maintained in OKD9, then it gets migrated as well. However, if you already have an entry for a cost, company code, cost element combination in OKD9, then that is kept as it is. And also there is no time dependency anymore for cost elements because they are merged with GL accounts. However, the cost element type and the functionality associated with it is retained. Okay, so now we have covered the basics. Okay, so Basically, we have covered basic overall design of S4, and we'll now get into COPA in detail. So the first thing is the tables. Okay, so the line items are stored in the table at Docker. Okay, the PA segments are stored in C4 XXXX. Here is the operating concern, as you would know. The TA segments are stored in the table C4. And basically in costing base, you still have the same table C1, C2, and C3. And the COEP is used for statistical postings. Yeah, not the real postings, but the statistical postings. For plan, currently the tables remain the same. COEJ will be for the line items, and then COSS and COHP for the totals. There is another table in the pipeline, ACDOCP, okay, accounting document planning. So that is in the pipeline, and it will come sometime in the future, for so that the planning is also in one table. Okay, but that is in the pipeline as of now. As far as C4 ACCP and C4 tables are concerned, this is changing with every release, okay? So the design is not stable here, and I'll explain this in the next slide. So in the initial design of S4 HANA, basically the thing was that we didn't need this C4 ACCP table anymore, because this table was introduced in the 40, I think release 45 or so long back, because of some performance reasons and so on. But with HANA, it was decided that we won't need this anymore. We will only have the C4 table. But there were some issues because of summarization and some performance issues as well. So with the implementation of this particular note, which is mentioned here, and I'll just show you this note. Okay, this is not S4 HANA note. This is a combined COPA note. Combined COPA is a new type of COPA again. It's called enhanced costing based or profitability subledger as well. But with this note coming into the system, we go back to the old design of C4 ACCT and C4 table. Okay. And then later on in this release 1709, we basically use only ACCT except for planning and assessment. Otherwise, most cases we will use ACCT. Only for planning and assessment we will use C4. So the configuration of the operating concern basically remains unchanged. Okay, what happens now is that the fields that used to be stored in table C4 will become part of the universal journal entry. So you will find fields for product, customer, region, distribution channel, and so on, alongside cost centers and other account assignments. The maximum number of characteristics in an operating concern has been increased to 60. Previously, as you know, 50 was the limit in the classical ERP. After adding a COPA characteristic to an operating concern, account base, of course, during generation of the client independent environment, the field is included in the ACDOCA table automatically from release 1603. Prior to that, there was a report that had to be run to put the characteristic into the ACS at Docker table. The derivation logic is remained unchanged by and large, no change in derivation. There are some new fixed fields which have been introduced. Okay, let me show it to you. Okay, in the meantime, you can see the ex-docker table here. Okay, so if I go to KEE file, and I can see the fixed fields from here. Okay, so you will see that you have the cost center now in the fixed fields. You have the functional area, and you also have the segment. Okay, so we get a lot of issues from customers after upgrading, suddenly I see new characteristics and all. So these are the fixed fees which have been introduced. In addition, you see this delivery and item. These are actually come from combined COPA. They are not from S4, but they are also included in here. Okay. And let's have a look at the ad hoc table as well. So if I collapse this, now what you see is that you see there are some fields which are there for all the which are common to all the modules, and then as you come down, you will see there are includes for every application: universal journal, additional entry, mandatory fields for GL, for asset accounting there's a separate include, material ledger has a separate include, and so on, right? What is important for us is this include, fdoc underscore si underscore copa, that is for the COPA fields. So once you go here, if you collapse through, you will see it consists of two includes. One is for the fixed fields and one is for the user defined fields. So in the fixed fields, so you will find some predefined fields as well, okay, like for example country key and all, and you find that material here is different. Okay, there are two materials in the SOCA table. One is for COPA, which is only the material which is sold, and there's a separate MAPNR which is for the material which is moved, which is relevant for MM or material ledger and so on. So these sometimes can be different, normally they'll be the same, but could be different at times. Yeah. And you don't find some fields here because they are already there in the this one. And again, if I want to see these are the user defined fields. Okay, so this is where you can see it in Adtalka. So I go back and I collapse again. So let me see some other fields. Like you have the fixed fields, right? Mandatory fields for GL. So here you can find some fields here. Okay, and also if I go back, GL additional, here you will find all the functional area, profit center, and all these are actually the fixed fields in COPA as well, but they are part of the GL here. Yeah, so that is the difference. One more thing is that you have this COBOL coding block extension, right? CI underscore COBOL. So coding block. So where the customer can extend the coding block. So the thing here is that the additional feature that we have here is you can have a table lookup on CI underscore COBOL to create characteristics from this coding block extension, and you can use derivation to fill it. And it can be used both as a source and target in derivation, and they can also be used for assessment and top-down distribution. Okay, normally, characteristic names can be 4 to 5 characters long, but in case of CI underscore COBL characteristic, the names can be up to 10 characters long. Another change is that we don't support the SAM banking operating concern anymore in S4HANA. It was there very rarely used, but we had a separate, for banking, we had a separate operating concern if customers wanted, but that's no longer available. Okay. If you migrate to SFN and you have only costing based active before and after migration, then KEQ3 settings are migrated to KEQ7. So we no longer have KEQ3. Okay, it's only KEQ7 irrespective of whether you use costing based or account based in SFIN or you use both. Okay, it's only KEQ7 now. So if you use only costing based before and after, then the settings get migrated. But if you activate account based after migration, or you have both account based and costing based before migration and after migration, then the settings are lost and you have to maintain in KEQ7 after the migration. Okay, I can probably just show you KEQ7 in the system. So you can see here, I put the country as a characteristic, and I said that it is for only for this company code, that you can summarize the country. Okay, so the conditional usage in Q3, we had some conditional usage of the segment level characteristics as well. That has been removed because it was rarely used and there were a lot of bugs as well in that. But we had decided to keep the company code, conditional usage for the company code, because that is something which makes sense and a lot of requirement is there as well. Other conditional usage of segment level characteristics is not allowed. Another change is that Q7, there's no separation for account-based and costing-based. In Q3, you could specify that you wanted something for costing-based and not for account-based, but in Q7, when you summarize something, it is applicable for both account-based and costing-based. And it's applicable for both AC/DOCA table and the C4 table. Both tables get summarized, okay, on the characteristic. So basically, we started SFIN with the assumption that we don't need summarization anymore. Okay, but then we had a requirement from retail customers, like these big supermarket chains and all. They have huge volume of data. So we had to implement the concept of summarization. Since we had removed the C4 ACCP table, we lost the characteristic values. So that is the reason why we are getting it back. Okay, because we don't want to lose the values completely. Okay, now we come to this concept of attributed profitability segments. Okay, what attributed profitability segment means is that if there is a cost element and COPA is active, okay, we will call derivation and fill whatever characteristic values can be populated, even if the real account assignment is different, like an internal order, for example. So let me just show you the customizing for this in the system. So in the master data, activate derivation for items without profitability segment. So here, these are the five cost objects to which you can post to and get an attributed profitability segment, which means the real, for example, internal orders. So here you have the different order types. Okay, so for example, you decide for development internal orders, okay, you take this P&L account. So what happens is every time there's a posting to this P&L account, to a P&L account for this internal order type, the system will call derivation and will try and populate as many characteristics as possible. Okay, so this is where the customizing is done. Similarly, for project sales orders, production orders, and all, you can do this. So once this is done, then the system calls derivation and tries to populate the characteristic. The COPA will not be the real account assignment. COPA will not be the real account assignment. The real account assignment will continue to be one of these, but COPA will be called and derivation will be done. So this is one additional feature that is there. Now from SFIN 3.0, that is S/4HANA 16.10, we have an additional feature. We will read the settlement rule for the cost object which will be posted to. So for example, you are posting to an internal order. What we will do is we will check if the internal order has a settlement rule first. Okay? If the internal order has a unique, the settlement rule has to be unique, okay? It cannot, if you have multiple settlement rules, we will not consider it because, for example, you have two settlement rules. One is to PA segment 1 and another to PA segment 2. We don't know which one to take. And this splitting and all is very complex, so it's not been implemented. So you need to have a unique settlement rule to a PA segment. So let's say you are doing an FB01 posting to an internal order. And that internal order has a settlement rule to COPA. So we will read the settlement rule and we will take whatever characteristics are there on the settlement rule and we will create an attributed profitability segment. The real account assignment will remain the internal order. Okay, but we'll have an attributed profitability segment which contains all the characteristics in the settlement rule. We will not call derivation in such cases. Now, what another feature is that if supposing the cost object doesn't have a settlement rule, but a sales order item is referenced in the master data of the account assignment object or in the transaction, then if a settlement rule to a profitability segment exists in the sales order item, the corresponding profitability segment data is read and transferred to EDDACA. If no settlement rule exists in the sales order item, but the sales order item does carry a profitability segment, EDDACA is enriched with the corresponding characteristics. If no profitability segment exists in the sales order item either, then fixed attributes like customer and product are copied from the sales order item or header or item, and in addition, COPA derivation is called. The resulting characteristics are written back to EDDACA. If a sales order is not found, but the document being posted is a SD billing document, then customer and product are copied from the billing document, COPA derivation is called, and EDDACA is populated with the resulting data. If this granularity level is enough for the customer, you don't need settlement. So the whole point of having attributed profitability segments is we want to get rid of settlements as far as possible. It's an additional activity that you do, settlement, period and closing. So we expect that we can substantially reduce the need for settlement. So that is a big change from the existing classical ERP. In case of cost centers, of course, there's no settlement rule, but if you are able to get from the derivation enough things, then probably you can reduce allocations as well. K30 reports will work as before, okay, but they don't read from the attributed profitability segments, only they read from the real profitability segments. Also, K28 currently does not work on attributed profitability segments, although we are looking at doing this feasibility of this in the future. Now we come to realignment. So there are a lot of limitations with realignment. Initially, it was not available. And then they, because EDDACA, the problem is that data is being used by several other applications, right? It's not specific to COPA like previously, where costing-based COPA has its own tables and we can change whatever we like. Here we have a lot of restrictions. So let me show you the system. Okay, so I try to create a realignment run. Okay, so the first thing you see in selection conditions here is the that you have specific EDDACA specific fields. Okay, for example, fiscal year. Now you see when I try to include this, one second. Okay. I tried to include this, I get a warning message. Okay, what does this warning message say? It says that this selection is only relevant for EDDACA. So if you do a selection of a fiscal year, let's say 2016, and you try to realign something. So in EDDACA, it will only be realigned for 2016. However, this is not applicable for the C4 table because there you don't have the fiscal year. So you, it will be realigned for all the applicable profitability segments in C4. So in this case, you could get a mismatch between ACDOCA and C4 for the other fiscal year. So that's something that you need to keep in mind. This is not an inconsistency or something. This is a design. This is something that you need to keep in mind if you select a fiscal year. Okay, now let's go to the conversion rule. You can see that there are some things in blue here. So if I try to select this, it will not allow. So not all characteristics can be changed. So we cannot change the company code, controlling area, and quantity units in realignment. Okay. Now let's take say cost center. Okay. Let's say that we realign cost center. Again, I get a warning message. So it says cost center in EDDACA table. Okay. It's only filled if it is initial. Okay. And this applies to WBS. This applies to internal order and. Also for sales order item and the cost object. Also for customer, sales or distribution channel, division, plant and billing time. And it is updated in the segment level table, but not in Adoka if a value is already there. The reason for this is because Adoka, the cost, suppose there's already an existing cost center. It's already being used by FI and all the other applications. If COPA changes it, you know, it could cause a problem for the other applications. So we only change it if it's initial. But in C4, it will be changed because that is our own table. So again, you could end up with a mismatch in C4 and Adoka. So you need to be careful when you use this. And regarding sales order and sales order item, they can only be changed for the attributed profitability segments. I will show you where it is. If you scroll down, you have this flag, right? Rederivation of for that attributed line item. So this way you can change the sales order and the sales order item. Now let's take, for example, functional area. Again, we get a warning message. It is relevant for legal reporting. So these can never be changed in Adoka. Company code and controlling area we have seen earlier. Functional area, business area, profit center, partner profit center and segment, as well as the coding block characteristics that I spoke about earlier. They can be used for legal reporting and for document splitting, so they cannot be changed in Adoka, but they can be changed in C4. So again, you could end up in a mismatch. So you have to be careful when you do realignment in S4. Yeah. But suppose you take something like, let's say, which is very specific to COPA. Okay, let me look at something. Yeah, for example, the sales office. Okay, it's a pure COPA characteristic. So you don't get any warning message, nothing. So you can change this because this is not used by all any other application. It's only applicable for COPA. Okay, so this is realignment. Now, top-down distribution, okay. So there, again, the basic design of top-down distribution remains the same. There are some changes with the, as you can see here, there are some changes with the processing instructions. Okay, again, we cannot, we can only copy the functional area, segment, cost element, and the profit center. We cannot summarize them. Again, this is because they have been used by the other applications and we don't want to change that. So there is a KBA which I have, which explains about this in detail. Okay, you can go through this KBA. So here, this was the initial design of top-down distribution. You can see that there are so many characteristics which were set to copy because we didn't want to change anything. Then later on, it was realized that, okay, we can change it, and there were some notes. So after this notes, we get only these restrictions. And I've given some workarounds here in case of that. And in here, you can see there's a wiki, okay? So if you go to that wiki, there is an example of the top-down distribution for the S4 finance, okay? There's an example of general example, but this is what is applicable. So that, as I said, I don't need to get into this in detail because the design remains the same of top-down distribution. It's just that we use the Adoka table instead of the C1 table now. And this explains to you how this works, a basic example to explain top-down distribution in S4. Okay. Now we have this COGS split as well. So the earlier the problem, and many customers, this was the reason they didn't want to use account based, was because in case of account based, you could not split the COGS based on the different cost components. In costing based COPA, you can map your value fields to the cost component structure and get a breakup of the COGS. So how much is labor, how much is material, how much is scrap, how much is admin, how much is electricity, labor, all these things. That was not possible in the traditional costing base. So this functionality is now available with S4. So I'll just explain to you in the system. Again, I'll show you the customizing for that in the system. So you go to financial accounting, you go to GL accounting, and then periodic processing, integration, materials management. So now you see here too, there are two functionalities available, define accounts for splitting the cost of goods sold and define accounts for splitting price differences. So let's have a look at this. Okay, so first thing you need to do here is create a cost splitting profile. Okay, for the controlling area chart of accounts, and you specify the cost component structure. So this is your cost account. Okay, so initially the entire amount will be on this. So let's say 100 euros is being for is the cost. So 100 euros will come on this account. Then the system will see that, okay, this is the cost component split. So what it will do is minus 100 on the same account. And then let's say each of these is 20. To make an easy example, each of these cost components is 20 each. So it will post 20 to each of them. So in Adoka, how this gets posted is that you'll first get one line item plus 100 on this COGS account. Then the second line item minus 100 again on this COGS account. And then you will get five line items, 20, 20, 20 each on each of these accounts. Okay, so that is how the COGS split happens. The default is like, it's compulsory, this default flag that you see. And the reason for that is, if you have any additional cost components, so let's say these are only five, but you have a material which has 20 cost components. So all the additional which are not mentioned here will be populated in the default, right? So we will not ignore anything. And there are also company code settings as well. So you can specify for this company code, you want this cost splitting profile. And I think in one of the releases, I think 16.05, you also give this option of valuation view. So you can decide that you want to take legal valuation or group valuation or profit center valuation for the cost split. Okay, if you have maintained your customizing in that way. There are some limitations here as well. This is only possible if there is a sales order in the process. Yeah. The material document should contain a reference to the sales order. We are getting requirements for customers for COGS splits during this STO, stock transfer order, but this is not possible currently because there is no sales order. And also in case of third party scenarios, this is not possible. Another limitation is we take only the main cost component split, not the auxiliary one. We also take the current standard cost estimate, not the past or the future. Yeah. And from 16.10, we will have a separate document for the cost split. Separate document means it will be posted in a separate ledger. So currently the way it works is in the same ledger, you get the reverse entry and then the splitting happens in the same ledger. And only the business transaction is different. I think it's called TBCS or something like that. So that tells you that business transaction in Adoka will tell you that, okay, this has come from the COG split. But from 16.10, the COG split is our own document in the sense that it is in a separate ledger and it will be shown as a separate document when you look at the accounting documents, right? And you can have a trace functionality as well for this, okay? So if you go to... So we have this trace functionality here. So if you give this object, give this sub-object, okay. Start from a previous state. Execute. Okay, I can see the cost split, the trace, and then it will tell me why it didn't work. Okay. For example, no customizing part for chart of accounts. If I take this customizing missing for company code, so I can get to know why the COG split didn't happen. Sometimes they say that there is no sales order. Okay, whatever, you can get to know the reason here. And if you want to set up this trace when there is a transaction to do so. Yeah, FCO, COGS, log activate. Okay, so if I run this, I just say this is a reference transaction, and then if I do it, it will activate in our system anyway, it's activated. Yeah, so you have to run this, activate it, and then the trace is on, and you can go and view it in SLG1 the way I have shown it. Yeah. Then another thing is the price differences. So let me go back. So this price difference splitting can only happen during the settlement of a production order to COCA. So you can split the variances, right? Instead of having one account with the total variances, you can get a split up of the variances. So again, here you have to have a profile, okay? So you can see here, there's only one maintained. So you can see cost element group. This is the input, okay? And target is this one, and you have the variance category here. So you have different variance categories. So you can specify whichever variance categories you want, give the source cost element, give the target account that you want to post to, and give the different variances. And then you can again have a default, so that if you have, let's say, specified 4 or 5 variances and there's an extra variance, it goes into the default. So this is kind of similar to the costing based, you know, we have this PA transfer structure where we can split the variances based on the variance category, and we can get it into different value fields, right? We can create different value fields for the different variance categories, and we can get a breakup of the variances. So this is again the same functionality in a different way. So again, it will be work out in the same way. You will get one line item on one account, and then you will it will get reversed, and then you will get multiple. We haven't seen customers using this much. We are getting a lot of queries on the COGS, but this doesn't seem to be used much. Now, this slide basically explains the same thing I have explained to you in the system. There are some prerequisites for the price difference. For example, you work with standard prices, you execute the variance calculation, you define the settlement profile. Similarly, there could be some prerequisites for the COGS also. Okay, all that stuff, the costing run has been executed, the prices in the material master are up to date. So this explains the same thing. Now, come to the benefits of using COPA. Okay, so we have the universal journal, which is basically your table at Docker, a single source of truth. So there is one table containing everything. No need to look into different tables. Extensibility, so only one table has to be enhanced. I have seen customers, you know, they will add a Z field in BSAG, and then they want the value to come in COPA. They will create a user-defined WW, some characteristic in COPA, then they will write custom code to move that BSAG Z field into the COPA characteristic. So these kind of things are not required. You just have to, if you have to enhance something, just add it in the one table, right? That all applications get it in Z field. And also FICO and COPA are integrated by default, so there is no need of any extra customizing to make this integration, especially you remember the real-time integration, right? If you wanted to move data from one cost center to another cost center and you want to reflect in FI, so to have that real-time integration. So here, everything is by default in a real-time integration. You don't need reconciliation efforts. We are seeing customers come to us with reports, okay, some ECPCA report, and they compare with COPA report, and somewhere, you know, one small thing is missing, and then you have to search for the needle in the haystack. And similarly, with GL reports, they will compare with COPA reports, and it's very difficult when you look at it on a monthly basis. So here, all these reconciliation efforts are not required because everything is in the same line. And then you have this profitability attributes, which I explained earlier. So this reduces the need for settlement substantially, and hence your period end closing could be faster. Also, this reduces the need for BI replication as well, because you have everything anyway in at Docker, and there are new reports being developed especially for at Docker, which use this embedded BW concept. So I think the BI replication, which a lot of customers do, you know, extracting data to BI, BW, doing the reporting there and all that, probably it will substantially reduce, and less interfaces and customizing as well. Now the limitations here. So as you have seen, there are some limitations with CogSplit. It's not as flexible as costing based. There is a limitation with the statistical SD conditions. Okay, in costing based COPA, you can get a COPA document, for example, for only quantity and no values. If you have free of charge items in SD billing documents, they are marked as statistical conditions in the billing document, and they are not relevant for accounting. So these are ignored by accounting, but they are considered in costing based COPA, right? In KE4I, you can map a statistical condition to a value field and get data. We cannot change this behavior because these items then would be relevant for taxation, which would be wrong from a business point of view. But we are looking at some workaround and see how we can, if we can get statistical ST conditions into account based COPA in some way or other. Some workaround is being looked at, but as of now, there is no breakthrough on that. Okay, then as you know, as you have seen, there are a lot of limitations with realignment in AppDocker because the fields are being used by all the other applications. We cannot just change something which is being used by other applications, right? And then we have this incoming sales order in costing based record type A. Here again, that is not possible. And periodic revaluation is currently not available. It is there again in the pipeline, but how it will come, when it will come, in what form it will come, we have to see. So to conclude, basically, costing based COPA is functionally more powerful and flexible than profitability analysis in the universal journal. We have tried to close the gap, and we are trying to close it all the time. Okay, but costing based COPA will always remain more flexible and more functionally rich, because this architectural foundation that we have with the universal journal has some constraints, because fields which are used by FI, such as profit center, functional area, and used by other applications, we cannot simply go ahead and change it in COPA. It will reflect on all the other applications, and that will not be acceptable by them. Also, like, you have these value fields in COPA costing base, where you can get like any kind of data you want. Again, here, because we